station. Any unattended articles are likely to be removed without warning.
This is the Hour of History Cities podcast with your host, Stephen Bauman. The Hour of History Cities podcast, as well as other Hour of History podcasts, can be streamed and downloaded at hourofhistory.com, iTunes, Google Music, our YouTube channel, and TuneIn. Be sure to also check out our Hour of History blog at hourofhistory.com/blog. And now we begin the Hour of History Cities podcast with your host, Stephen Bauman.
The town was uniformly built in the form of a hollow square, with an area of 50 to 100 feet each way with the occasion of Hindu festivals. It's covered, and when it's lighted up, it looks very handsome. The house itself is seldom more than two stories, the lower portion on three sides of it used only for storerooms or for domestics. On the remaining side, and that always the northern one, is to be found Thakur Ghar, or abode of the Hindu gods. This is always finished with care, and when the owner is wealthy, the lusters contained in this sacred apartment are of considerable value. Above the stairs are the public apartments, with verandas, always inwards. These are generally long, narrow slips containing a profusion of lusters and wall lights, altogether affording but a mean view to a European. Jutting out from this main building are situated the accommodations allotted to the females and the families. They consist of smaller hollow squares with petty verandas opening inwards, and some houses have two or three sets of these zenanas with one or more tanks attached, but which are generally kept in a neglected state. This is the account of a European traveler who's walking through the black town of Calcutta. Now, I know. My last two items, the Black Hole of Empire and the Bengali Renaissance, weren't really items per se, but they were good representations of the growth that was happening in Calcutta under the British Empire, the British regime that took over and took control shortly after this Battle of Plassey in the late middle 18th century. So now I introduce you with that reading to what was called the Black Town of Calcutta, and it has been used by a lot of authors, most of them British, most of them imperial, to describe the separation that was taking place in this new Calcutta that was becoming quickly one of the most important imperial cities in the British Empire. There was a division, they said, between Black Town and White Town. And for a long time, people have used this division to make Calcutta into a separated, segregated city between the empire and between the natives. And this was sort of the idea that was sold back to Britain, that there was a sort of separation between the two, and that it was possible to discern what they were. In this episode, with my next two items, taking me up to item six, I use the Black Town and the White Town as representative not only of how Calcutta has been understood in the past by historians, but also by how it's sort of misrepresentative of what actually was happening in Calcutta, and misrepresentative of cities in general. A lot of times people like to understand cities with a clear dividing line, and it's certainly true in some cases. In some cities, you can cross a street and be in an entirely different area. That absolutely happens throughout the world, and we study some cities. That's an important feature of that city. People wanted to do that with Calcutta, with the Black and White Towns, and you read some of these travel logs that sort of explain what happened, like the one I just did, and they describe an area that's different, in a city's houses that are built for Bengalis, or as the English called them, Babu, which was mostly pejorative, a way of saying, like, sort of different than European, a Bengali describing someone that was of lower class. And the British would almost always say that the Babus lived in the Black Town, whereas the British lived in the White Town. But the thing is, the Black Town, this area that was sort of away from Fort William, away from the English center of Calcutta, was that it was much more diverse. There were middle-class Babus. There were middle-class Bengalis who had made a significant amount of money and had built respectable houses in this town. Like the one described is a multiple-story house that has room, separate quarters for the women and separate areas in which the house is divided, and a lot of possessions that can be stored underneath, and a lot of space in a lot of areas. There were rather wealthy clerks and people who worked within the British imperial system. Because one of the things about the British imperial system, especially in Calcutta, was that the British set it up so most of the work was done by Bengalis. So most of the administrative work was staffed by Bengalis. They far outnumbered the British. And so there were people in Bengal who made quite a good career out of it. In addition to this, and one of the focuses of the Black Town typically, is that there are a lot of migrants coming to Calcutta. So what was once a fishing village in the 18th century, in the 19th century has over 200,000 people as early as 1820. So people from all over Bengal, which is quickly becoming controlled large part by the East India Company, are coming to Calcutta for a chance of making a life. So amongst these big middle class Bengali mansions are also small little villages, tiny alleys, crowded bazaars, and huts that are not quite as nice as some of these areas that are described in this tourist account. But one thing to mention is that these people are being successful in finding jobs, and they have to be employed in British places. So although the Black Town is on the other side of Calcutta, separated by a main road from the White Town, and there's numerous paras, tolas, and tulis, which are the actual sort of like neighborhoods and areas and constructions within the city, the Europeans sort of categorize it in this way, but a lot of the people who come to live in Calcutta end up going between these areas because a lot of the jobs are in the White Town, working in a lot of the British companies, whether it's working as a clerk or it's working as a servant in one of the British manors. Here's a description of the White Town, so we get a little contrast before I explain that the contrast gets muddled by the amount of traversing between the two. Written in 1780, the streets are broad, the line of buildings surrounding two sides of the esplanade of the fort, that's Fort William, is magnificent, and it adds greatly to the superb appearance that the houses are detached from each other and insulated in a great space. The buildings are on a large scale from the necessity of having free circulation of air. The general approach to these houses is by flight of steps, with great projecting porticos, surrounded by colonnades or arcades which give them the appearance of Grecian temples. The English quarter occupies the south end of the city. Here a beautiful plain, a mile and a half long, goes down the water's edge, having Fort William in the center on the river bank. On its inner sides, the plain is bordered with the stately houses of the English, with their white walls, broad open verandas, and green Venetian shutters. On the east side are the numerous English homes of the Chowringhi, always increasing, both in numbers and in their rents. So this explains sort of the idyllic vision that's being sent home of the White Town. So the contrast that the British wanted to describe and do this and classify, and this is part of the imperial project, is one of the goals of empire was always to classify everything, to understand everything, to put everything in its place. This goes here and this goes here. And part of that was present in the White Town. There were It was sparsely populated when compared to the Black Town. There were things like the governor's house, which were meant to replicate an English country manor. It was closer to the fort, always near that reminder of the black hole of empire. It features the Maidan, which is has been called the lungs of Calcutta. It's a giant green space. That it's space compared to more densely populated area in the Black Town. At the same time, the White Town and the Black Town of Calcutta are never homogeneous. They always have groups going back and forth from each end. There's overlapping geographies that are crossing streets. People are free to move between the spaces. There are certainly access restrictions to places like the governor's mansion, but there are quite a few Indians who are working in the governor's mansion as servants, not to mention the amount of British generals who also have mistresses and wives, even of Indian descent. So there's mixed families, and that begins to become less and less as more British women start coming to Calcutta, as it becomes more and more important in the British Empire. But at the beginning of this, there's an enormous amount of crisscross between these places. The black town and the white town, although in an imperial textbook or a travelogue might seem like the most separate places on Earth, are enormously connected spaces. Hybrid cultures are created inside of Calcutta, and they flow directly through the black town and the white town. So while one resident of the 19th century Calcutta might understand between Theatre and Wood Street there's an enormous amount of European wealth, they would know that you go just one street down and you're going to be able to find a crowded bazaar, even though it's not necessarily supposed to be in that area. Additionally, as groups begin to gain more money, as the Bengali Renaissance takes off, people like the Tagores, the family of the famous poet Rabindranath Tagore, begin to buy houses in the White Town. So White Town is not even exclusively English. There's diversity of residents. So Calcutta continues to grow. It has this sort of imperial imagination where there is a separation. The British see their buildings as different, but in reality, it's created in a hybrid culture that's much more like the sort of diversity that India typically sees. There's houses of worship for almost every religion. There's Buddhism. There's a new cathedral built, St. Paul's, just like that of London. And there's Hindu temples, there's Muslim mosques, there's Zoroastrian temples, there's all sorts of religious, different, diverse, and hybrid cultures that are present throughout India. So despite the rhetoric of the imperial project, Calcutta sort of begins to live by its own rules. And as Calcutta grows over 200,000, which is rather significant for the early 1800s, the British lose the American War, they turn their focus to India, and Calcutta becomes the capital of the British enterprise in India, and it remains the most important city for much of the 19th century. So two cities in the British Empire begin to develop extraordinarily fast in the 19th century, London and Calcutta. And Calcutta becomes enormously important in the British Empire. So in finishing this week and my two not really items as much as they are ideas, the black town and the white town, you can already see the tension beginning to grow between this idea of neat scientific classification that is brought on by the British and the imperial project, and between the hybrid heterogeneous realities of life in a diverse and vibrant country like India. So this is item number 5 and 6, week 3. I've only got 2 more weeks and 4 more items to get Calcutta from the 19th century to modern present day Calcutta. Hopefully I can make it. Remember, don't forget to check out hourofhistory.com/blog for some additional comments on these topics and some additional sources. Thanks a lot for listening. This is Hour of History, our world, anytime, anyplace. Jai Shri Baba.